In addition to such questions as do we share the same reality and what is real, philosophers debated what makes people human, or more precisely, are the mind and body separate? One group believed that the body is separate from the mind, also called the soul or psyche. This position is called dualism. For dualists, the mind can exist without the body. Consequently, the soul can exist after death. The opposing view is there is only one aspect. This view is called monism. The majority of monists hold the view that all that exists is the body, but some monists hold that all that exists is the spirit. Sometimes called the father of modern psychology, René Descartes was born in La Haye, France in 1596. Although he came from a wealthy family, he was in poor health most of his life. Educated at the College of Lafiche, a Jesuit school, Descartes believed that God created the universe, set it in motion, and left it alone. He held that since God was not involved in the day-to-day operations of the universe, it is possible to study the universe and its laws without making theological statements. Descartes maintained that animals were basically machines. And like animals, man's body is a machine, but he has a soul. In his view, the soul is more interconnected with the body than either St. Thomas or St. Augustine. And unlike Aristotle, Descartes knew where the soul resides. He maintained that the soul and body come together in the pineal gland. It's called the pineal gland because it is a small pinecone-shaped gland that has no duplicates and is located in the middle of the brain. According to Descartes, the eyes send gases through the nerves, hollow tubes, to the pineal gland and make an impression on it. That's why the eyes reveal the inner soul. These gases, which were thought to be distilled from blood, were called animal spirits, in the same way that drinks, which contain distilled alcohol, are called distilled spirits. Although he compared the body to a machine, Descartes believed in psychophysical interaction. The body influences the soul through perception, and the soul influences the body to speak, move, and act. Sayings attributed to Descartes include, "I think, therefore I am." Each problem that I solve became a rule, which served afterwards to solve other problems. Except for our own thoughts, there is nothing absolutely in our power. If you would be a seeker after truth, it is necessary that at least once in your life you doubt as far as possible all things. In order to prove the mind, we ought less to learn than to contemplate. It is not enough to have a good mind. The main thing is to use it well. An optimist may see a light where there is none, but why must the pessimist always run to blow it out? It is easy to hate, and it is difficult to love. This is how the whole scheme of things works. Descartes' solution to the mind-body problem was to choose both mind and body. In contrast, Thomas Hobbes chose a monistic view. He asserted that only the body exists. After visiting Galileo in 1635, Hobbes was convinced that the universe is composed only of matter and motion. For him, man is a machine whose mental activity was reducible to the motion of atoms in the brain. Hobbes was a physical monist who maintained that mental activity was a function of the brain, and that free will, spirit, and mind were illusions. Although Hobbes was friends with Francis Bacon and served as his secretary for a short time, he rejected Bacon's inductive reasoning in favor of the deductive reasoning preferred by his other friends, Galileo and Descartes. Hobbes concluded that people are neither basically good or bad. They are neutrally hedonistic, self-oriented. Hobbes reintroduced Plato's and Aristotle's concept of association of ideas. He held that ideas tend to follow each other, like cars in a train. These trains of thoughts are often unguided and rambling, but they become orderly when two ideas are similar. Quotes attributed to Hobbes include, "Leisure is the mother of philosophy." "The universe is corporeal. All that is real is material, and what is not material is not real. Of the voluntary acts of every man, the object is some good to himself." Appetite, with an opinion of attaining, is called hope. The same, without such opinion, despair. His attributed last words were, "I am about to take my last voyage, a great leap into the dark." In the 17th century, Baruch Spinoza proposed a sort of neutral monism. In his view, God has no personality. He reasoned that if God and nature are names for the same substance, then there's only one set of rules governing everything. Consequently, Descartes was wrong. The body and the soul are not separate. They are the same thing. And if there is no separate spiritual life, the Bible, what Christians call the Old Testament, is a collection of metaphors and allegories. Spinoza's views were not popular with his Jewish community, partly because they were in opposition to his theological heritage, and partly because his community was afraid the few freedoms they had in Amsterdam would be revoked by the offended Christians. So in 1656, they excommunicated Spinoza and shunned him from the community. The 17th century Irish clergyman George Berkeley was also a monist, but unlike Hobbes, Berkeley, or Berkeley, proposed that all that exists is the mind. Presented as an apologetic, Bishop Berkeley argued that knowledge is based on perception. There's no reality in the perception itself, it is the mind which interprets the sensations. A spiritual monist, Berkeley held that physical objects are composed of ideas. He reasoned that the universe has spirits which perceive and ideas which are perceived. Perceiving presupposes a mind. Since we share many perceptions, the source of these perceptions must be God's mind. In mathematics, Berkeley is best known for his attack on the assumptions underlying Newton's calculus. He noted that calculus was more like a religion than a science, since its foundations were not well understood. In philosophy, Berkeley was an extreme empiricist. All we know comes from our perceptions. He added the twist that perceptions require a mind, but his underlying principles did not include innate ideas or pre-wired categorizations. Quotes attributed to Berkeley include, "All the choir of heavens and furniture of earth, in a word, all those bodies which compose the frame of the world, have not any substance without a mind. We have first raised a dust, and then complain we cannot see. From my own being, and from the dependency I find in myself and my ideas, I do, by an act of reason, necessarily infer the existence of a God, and all things created in the mind of God." What is mind? No matter. What is matter? Never mind.